Problem five, two solid cylinders are mathematically similar. The sum of their heights is 1. The sum of their surface areas is 8 pi. The sum of their volumes is 2 pi. Find all possibilities for the dimensions of each cylinder. We should start this problem by choosing some variables to describe the sizes of the two cylinders. So I'm going to take my first cylinder and say that it has base radius r and height h. Then we know that the second cylinder is similar, and I'm going to write x for the scale factor. So that's going to mean that it has radius rx and height hx. And using those, I'm now going to write out the equations that represent the things that we were given in the problem. The first equation is the one for the sum of the heights. And the heights, as we've just said, we're going to call h and hx. And so the first equation says they add up to 1. Then there's the equation for the sum of the surface areas. So the surface area of the first cylinder is made up of two parts. So the first part is 2 pi r squared. So that's 2 lots of pi r squared, representing the top disk and the bottom disk. And then there's the curved surface area, which is 2 pi rh, because you can make it by bending a rectangle of width 2 pi r, which is the circumference, and height h. Then the other two terms are very similar. So we get the flat surface area and the curved surface area of the other cylinder, but the radius and the height of the other cylinder are just obtained by multiplying by x. So they're the same, only with an extra x squared term. So that's 2 pi r squared x squared, and 2 pi r h x squared. And we're told that those all add up to 8 pi. Then lastly, there's the equation for the volumes. Now, the volume of the first cylinder is going to be pi r squared h, because it's a prism of base area pi r squared and height h. And the volume of the other cylinder is going to be similar, only with an x cubed in, because the radius and the height are the same multiplied by x. So we get pi r squared h x cubed, and we're told that those all multiply to, those all add up to 2 pi. Now, there's plenty of work we can do to simplify and factorise these equations. The first one, I'm just going to take a factor of h out. So I get h times 1 plus x, and that's equal to 1. With the second one, there's more I can do. So the first thing I notice is that there's a factor of 2 pi everywhere. Every term I see is a multiple of 2 pi. But there's more. So on the left, every factor is a multiple of r, and then they come in two pairs, one with an extra r and one with an h, one with an extra r and one with an h. And then these terms here have an x squared, and these terms don't. So that tells me I can factorise it, and what I get is that r times r plus h times 1 plus x squared equals 4. So that's me taking out the 2 pi and then factorising. Then the last equation, I can take out a factor of pi and then factorise, and that means I write it as r squared h 1 plus x cubed equals 2. Now, things are going to go very much easier if I spot here that this equation is a multiple of this equation. So I've got an h here and an h here, but it may not be so obvious that this term here is a multiple of this. However it is, I can write this as r squared 1 minus x plus x squared equals 2. So this depends on you knowing that 1 plus x cubed is 1 plus x times 1 minus x plus x squared. This is a standard factorisation, but it's not one that's very well known. However, you can check it for yourself, and it is true. So what can we do with these? To me, the natural thing to do seems to be to get everything in terms of x. With the first equation, I can do this by writing h equals 1 over 1 plus x. And with the last equation, I can do this by writing r as the square root of 2 divided by 1 minus x plus x squared. So now we've got those, I can use this expression for h and this expression for r and substitute them into the middle equation, and I'll get an equation in the one variable x. But I'm going to need a bit more space on the whiteboard to do that. So this is that middle equation. I've taken both the occurrences of the variable r and replaced them with a square root, and I've taken the occurrence of the variable h and replaced it with 1 over 1 plus x. Now I'm going to have to try to simplify this. The first thing I want to do is get rid of the denominators. So I'm going to multiply both sides by 1 minus x plus x squared, so it'll deal with this in the square root and also this in the square root. And I'm also going to multiply both sides by 1 plus x to deal with that. Let's see what happens when we do that. So I get root 2 from here, multiplied by root 2 times 1 plus x, plus the square root of 1 minus x plus x squared, times 1 plus x squared. That's the left-hand side. What happens to the right-hand side? Well, we're multiplying by 1 minus x plus x squared and by 1 plus x, but we know what those multiply to. As I said earlier, what I get when I multiply those two together is 1 plus x cubed. Now, if I multiply out this square root of 2 with this bracket, it's going to be a bit nicer. And when I do that, I'm going to end up with 2 lots of 1 plus x plus the square root of 2 times 1 minus x plus x squared times 1 plus x squared, and that's going to be equal to 4 lots of 1 plus x cubed again. Okay. The only strategy I can think of is try to get the square root on its own so that I can square both sides. So in order to do that, I'm going to move this term over to the right-hand side. So when I do that, I get square root of 2 times 1 minus x plus x squared times 1 plus x squared equals 4 lots of 1 plus x cubed minus 2 times 1 plus x times 1 plus x squared. Now, this right-hand side can be simplified. When I do that, I get 4 plus 4x cubed minus 2 minus 2x minus 2x squared minus 2x cubed. So this is equal to 2 minus 2x minus 2x squared plus 2x cubed, and that's equal to 2 lots of 1 minus x squared plus x cubed. Now the only thing I can see how to do from here is square both sides, and that will work insofar as it will give us a polynomial equation for x. But we're going to need a bit more whiteboards to see what we do get and to see what we do once we've done it. If you do all the work of squaring that equation and then gathering like terms together and then dividing both sides by 2, you're left with this equation. And if you like, you can pause the video now and check that this is indeed what you get. This is a degree 6 equation, and I don't know anything about solving degree 6 equations in general. So we best hope that if we're to solve it, there had better be something special about it. And I think there clearly is. I think the coefficients of this equation read the same forwards and backwards. We've got a 1 at both ends with a minus 3 just inside, then a minus 5, and then a 10. That means I can make it more symmetric if I divide by x cubed. So if I divide both sides by x cubed, which I can do because I don't care about x being 0, the scale factor can't be 0, I get x cubed minus 3x squared minus 5x plus 10 minus 5x to the minus 1 minus 3x to the minus 2 plus x to the minus 3 equals 0. That's nicely symmetric, and it means I can make it simpler by using a substitution. If I let t equals x plus x to the minus 1, this will make things much nicer. In actual fact, I could have spotted this much earlier in the problem. So whenever I have a solution for x, I also get a solution for x to the minus 1, because I could swap the two cylinders over. If I have a solution where the scale factor is x, then by thinking the second cylinder is the first one, I get a solution where the scale factor is x to the minus 1. But we got this far without spotting that, but now it's useful. If you do try the substitution, and again, you could check for yourself by pausing that this is what you get, you find the equation t cubed minus 3t squared minus 8t plus 16 equals 0. This is a cubic equation in t. I'm much happier about this than I was about the degree 6 equation in x, but I still better hope that I can spot something special in order to solve it. But I think I can. I think I can spot that t is 4 is a solution of this equation. Indeed, 4 cubed is 64. 3 times 4 squared is 48. 8 times 4 is 32. And if I add 64 and 16, I get 80, which is exactly what I get if I add 48 and 32. So that means 4 is a solution, which means I get a factor of t minus 4. Then I can go to the effort of working out what the other factor has to be. There'll be a t squared, because t times t squared has to be t cubed. And there'll be a minus 4, because minus 4 times minus 4 is 16. Then I wonder what the other term is, and if I look at the term minus 8t, I realise that it's got to be plus t. So that this minus 4 times this t plus this minus 4 times this t will give me minus 8t. So I've got a factorisation of this equation. Now, this means that t could be 4, and this is a quadratic, which I can solve to find some other values of t. How's this look? Well, the quadratic formula says that t is going to be minus 1 plus or minus the square root of 1 plus 4 times 4, so square root of 1, square root of 17, all divided by 2. But I should be a bit suspicious about this. One of these solutions is negative, in fact. So when t is minus 1 minus root 17 all over 2, that'll be negative. And that doesn't seem to make sense. So I can't have t being negative because it's a sum of a positive thing and a positive thing. But more is true. In fact, if I consider that root x minus 1 over root x all squared has to be positive, or at least non-negative, when I multiply that out, I get that x plus 1 over x is greater than or equal to 2. So in order to make sense, t has got to be at least 2. And you can check quickly that even if I take the positive square root, even if I take minus 1 plus root 17 over 2, I still don't get something that's bigger than 2. So neither of these solutions make any sense for us. So what we get is that t is 4. Let's look at what that means for the original problem. So what we have left to do is to substitute those back into the original equations and work out what happens. And with a bit of work simplifying what we get, we find that x is 2 plus or minus root 3, and that h is 3 plus or minus root 3 all over 6, and that r is 3 plus or minus root 3 all over 3. We should check that those work by substituting them back into the original equations. We ought to do this because we squared something along the way, and that might have introduced new and spurious solutions. The other thing I'd like to say is that there's really only one solution here, not two. One value of x is for the small cylinder being the first cylinder and the scale factor being larger than 1, and the other value of x is for the big cylinder being the first cylinder and then the scale factor being less than 1.